And time permitting, if the situation improves in the coming months, say by June, July, and children are allowed to come to school, we will have another formal DP graduation ceremony. So don't lose hope on that matter. But you know, we are living in a very uncertain world, and in an uncertain world, we have to be prepared for all types of challenges. This morning, I will speak to you about the emerging leadership philosophy in the world today, which is different to what it was till yesterday. And leadership philosophy in a post-corona world. And how do we prepare for it? That, I think, is the theme of my talk to you this morning. And I would like you to take notes whenever possible, because wherever you go, whichever university you go, wherever you go in life, this is going to be the yardstick. It will give you time to reflect. It will give you time to introspect on your readiness as leaders in a post-corona world. It is not only post-corona. It is not only about pandemics. The other threats to global security, like climate change. I feel climate change will have a bigger impact than any virus, including the Spanish flu of 1918. If the global temperatures rise above 2 degrees Celsius, hell will break loose. Large sections of countries on the sea will be inundated. Bombay is one. Bangladesh is another. Florida and all that part, southern part over there, parts of Korea, Japan, they'll be totally inundated. There'll be mass migrations will take place. And therefore, it is not only the corona which is worrisome. It is the threat to global security that increasing. There are computer viruses which are going to possibly have a bigger impact than corona. Internet will crash. Healthcare, financial markets will all tumble down. And therefore, we need to understand that education cannot remain an onlooker. There's going to be bioterrorism. Now, terrorists know that they have got ample proof now to develop these viruses, which can be easily done in the garage of your apartment. And they can localize the spread of these germs, biological germs, in target populations. They can do it now. Imagine these being put in slums and people who are living in congested areas over there. What psychological impact it will have. Cyber security. We were in Israel about some months back, 8-9 months back. We were in Israel. Their best brains from school and college who joined the army, they all have to join the army. They go into cyber terrorism and cyber security. Their best brains are there. To be posted to a cyber unit over there has got 10 times more value than going to Stanford or Harvard. Their placements are not about Stanford, Harvard and London and this and that. Their placements are that when they join the army, which they have to do immediately after school, which are those units they're going to go to. And they're so serious that kids from 9th onwards, 9th, 10th, 11th and 12th, they attend college simultaneously. Therefore, a kid who's in grade 9, in the morning, she comes to school. And in the afternoon, she goes to the university, the top universities of the world. And she's doing astrophysics. She's doing mathematics. You name it. So when they graduate from school, they've graduated from university also. Then they join the army. And these kids who go to the top of the creamy layer, you know, cyber terrorism and cyber threats. Today, the danger of hacking human brains has gone up. We've seen that in Brexit. We've seen that in the American elections. Today, corporations and states have the power to manipulate our thinking and our behavior. They can make us buy what they want us to buy. They know more about us than we know about ourselves. So it is not just the corona threat which is worrisome. the world is becoming more and more unstable and insecure, and pandemics will come and pandemics will go, but the threat to global security is increasing. And I would like you to keep in mind that you need to go flat out and develop those capabilities of how you are going to navigate through this uncertain world, this VUCA plus world, and I'll come to VUCA plus in a minute. I would like you to look at the present corona pandemic as a crucible experience. It is something positive that has happened to us. For all these hundreds of years in our country, Asiatic countries over there, innovation was absent. Today, our IITs, our IIMs, our premier companies over there, in the last 73 years, have not produced one innovation. We are good in Jugaad, but we are not good in innovation. And this is a crucible experience. It is a reminder. It is written on open skies in bold letters. Only the innovative will survive. Those who are not innovative will perish. If you are not innovative, my friends, you have no damn hope in heaven or in hell to survive. You'll be dead as dodos. This is a crucible experience. It has created that disruption that is forcing us now, right from age 3 onwards, to be creative and innovative. We have been saying this for the last 8 to 9 years, but on many years it has fallen deaf. Corona is something good that has happened to humanity. It has created the understanding that if we are not innovative, our survival is at stake. Corona has brought the world together. We all join hands together. It is goes across all borders, all religions, all cultures. And it is a great opportunity for us to reconnect with ourselves. Because of social media, mainly, your generation particularly has not been able to connect with yourself. So all those 1,000, 2,000 kids you got on your Facebook, they are not your friends. You must be stupid to think that they are your friends. They're acquaintances. And if you want to spend all your time on social media, which all of us have been doing, even grown-ups have been doing over there, we have no time for ourselves. Corona, lockdowns, quarantines, isolation connects us with ourselves. We become human. We start reflecting. We start introspecting. I want to underscore, and I would like you to write down on your paper, innovation is the only vaccine against corona. It is the steroid. Innovation is the steroid that is going to make you a wartime leader. Innovation is the only vaccine against corona. Innovation is the only vaccine, is the only solution for dealing with all the global threats. The world has started to see it. And this is the foundation of your leadership philosophy. You have to build your leadership philosophy on this. So let us see some of the major impacts that the present pandemic has on traditional leadership. What we have been doing all this year. Firstly, I think the important thing to understand is all workplaces, schools, universities, where you're going to go, workplaces where you're going to go, have been turned into war zones, then the combat zones. In combat zone, you don't know who's your enemy. In this new combat zone, it's like in being in Beirut or being in Syria or being in Iraq. You have no idea. We're into a war zone now. Therefore, our mentality has then got to be not of a poodle, but of a Doberman, of a Rottweiler. we have to be constantly on our toes. Take an example of Israel. When we were in Israel, we saw young men, young women who had joined the army, who were on leave, or who were in station over there. They're going out for a date. They're going out for dinner. They've got their assault rifles there. Each woman has got an assault rifle there. Each man has got his assault rifle there. The moment they get the code, in 4 hours, they go into combat. From eating hamburgers, they're into battle in 4 hours. They carry their gun and ammunition and they sleep with them. When they come to university, their locker's got the gun with them there. In every house, in every corporate building, on every floor, there is a bomb shelter against missile attacks, against nuclear attacks. So like in our hotels, we say that in case of fire, you go down the staircase to your left or to your right there. There, the moment something happens, the code word comes, the families, the kids, the employees, they all rush into the bomb shelter. That is a level of readiness. Ladies and gentlemen, we are living in a tough neighborhood. And therefore, even Fortune 500 companies, which are 80, 90 years old, they're all in a startup mode. They can collapse tomorrow morning. Google can collapse tomorrow. Amazon can collapse tomorrow. There's no guarantee. Nobody can say that everything is hunky-dory. No idea. Tomorrow, cyber terrorists can siphon off Bill Gates and Bezos' money overnight. It can be done. And I'm sure people are working on it. Therefore, we are in a war zone and we are in a startup boat ready to go into combat immediately. Therefore, our psyche has to be different. The way we work has to be different, the way we live, the way we learn, the way we love, the way we relate to people has to be different. We are in a war zone. And our leadership philosophy of a war zone is different to peacetime leadership. In peacetime environment, you've got managers. In wartime, there are no managers. Everybody is a leader. Come to that little later. The second big impact I see is that we are in a world which I would call VUCA plus. The difference between VUCA and VUCA plus is this, that in VUCA, the VUCA comes and it goes. It's like an event. Something happens, the creators come down there, then we get back to business as usual. A cyclone comes, a tsunami comes, we get back to usual after a little time. In VUCA plus, the situation continues, can continue for months and for years. That is the difference. It's like you're having asymptomatic corona. You don't know, but it's there. You got it. So when uncertainty lasts for a very long time, volatility lasts for a very long time, when you are required to live in a tough rubber neighborhood a long time, randomness, instability, and uncertainty are the watchwords. That is a VUCA plus, where the thing continues for a long time. And you've got to live with it. It's like being diagnosed to have cancer. You've got to live with it. Even after surgery, you've got to live with it. You've got to be very careful about it. It can come back again. The third very great impact which I see is the obsolescence. Obsolescence is now the order of the day. Take Moore's law. Moore's law says that in 24 months, the computing power doubles. This is no longer true. Things can change in 20. jobs, technologies, education, schooling, medicine, politics, economics, systems and processes. Systems and processes are more for peacetime mode. In a wartime mode, systems and processes, you need a different set of systems and processes for wartime. You know, asking everybody what is to be done and this and that. Can you imagine a combat leader in Afghanistan or Iraq, somewhere over there, with militants firing at him, is going to have a conference, a video conference, to ask people, what do we do now? What do you think, Rizwan? What do you think, Luvera? What do you think, Akhil? What do you think, Aditya? What should we do now? Ramesh, you got to take a decision immediately. You got to have that intuitive capability. There's system one thinking comes in there. There is no system two thinking where there is, you delay something called leadership speed. Leadership speed is your ability to think faster than what your opponent is thinking and outthink him. You need leadership speed. You have leadership speed in you. And the fourth big impact I feel is the collapse of standardization. Standardization is the enemy of innovation. Standardization is a peacetime model. It works well when things are very stable, in stable conditions. A standardized method model would be command and control. Principal, vice principal, heads of school, coordinators, schools, there's a chain of command. It's not relevant in a wartime scenario. It's based on titles. A lot of us love titles and positions. Call me anything, but give me some sort of a title. If nothing else, call me an associate. Call me this, call me that. It's about hierarchy. We experience that at home. We experience that in our society, and we experience that in schools. Hierarchy, hierarchical model. We all work in silos. And we get offended if any intruder comes and tries to enter our silo. Who the hell are you in the jungles? You mark a territory. And we don't allow anybody to come inside our territory. IB is an example. CBS is an example. They've all marked their territories. They're all silos. If anybody from CBSE comes to IB, we say, what do you know about IB? Son, you take your time to understand and learn. This is not CBSE. This is not ICSE. This is not this, this is not that. Therefore, we have now moved into the age of personalization. There'll be personalization in healthcare. For the same headache which Akshita has, she will get a dolo, and the same headache which Aditya has, he will get some different medicine. You can't give a dolo to everybody who's got a headache. It'll be personalized. Medicines will be personalized. Education will be personalized. Even you will be personalized. You have to start learning on your own. You have to take ownership of your own learning. Don't wait for teachers to come and teach you. If they come, well and good. If they don't come, so be it. Your leadership has to be personalized. You have to be an outlier. If you're not an outlier, you're nobody. You're a face in the crowd. Therefore, in this age of me, you're all in that age of me, we must shift from ruling by standardization in our personal life, in our work life, to leading with personalization. That's very, very important. So these are the four factors. There are many others, but these are the key ones which will impact on our new leadership philosophy. One is that we are in a wartime zone. We are on our toes. Anybody can hit us. We have to be on guard. If something happens, we have got to go into war with what we have. You go to war with what you have. You can't now sit back and say, oh, I need so much money, I need this, I need so many teachers, I require this and I require that. You go to war with what you have. Second day, I spoke to you about VUCA Plus, the difference between VUCA Plus and VUCA. I spoke to you about obsolescence, which is growing and increasing. Knowledge, technologies, job, all getting outdated. And I spoke to you about that standardization is the enemy of innovation. Ladies and gentlemen, all entrepreneurs are leaders. But most leaders are not entrepreneurs. All leaders are not entrepreneurs. All entrepreneurs are leaders. So when we talk of having a wartime mentality, a wartime mentality is an entrepreneurial mentality. Your DNA has to change in having an entrepreneurial mentality. And today you have to reflect and ask yourself, am I an entrepreneur? If not, how far away from the goalpost am I? Peacetime leaders, they do well in stable conditions. They are, I would call, chocolate soldiers. When nothing much is happening, the sun is shining, weather is good, the birds are singing in the trees, money is there, mobile is there, Instagram is there, I've got my credit cards with me, I have no responsibility. It's good life. I mean, so-called good life. I don't think it's good, but so-called good life. This is good. So, they're all right for stable condition. But the moment instability comes, they crack, they crumble. You will find that nearly all peacetime leaders can never become wartime leaders. But wartime leaders can become peacetime leaders. Now, peacetime leaders, they do well because, let me give you an example from a company. They are more concerned about the financial market, about their quarterly results. It's what is called as, now it's been called a shareholder capital. Shareholders have invested their money over there, they want their money back. It's called shareholder capitalism. The customer be damned, the society be damned. As long as shareholders get their money, it's okay. Now that is one big change that is already happening, my friends, because the world is now waking up to this thing. Culture. We have to build organization culture. That in HP, this is what happens. In Amazon, this is the culture. In Google, this is the culture. In IBM, this is the culture. In India, this is the culture. CEOs and leaders are busy expanding markets. More products coming into the market. More technology coming into the market. More money being made over there. And the moment a shot is fired, the first thing which they do is to sack their employees. And peacetime leaders, they go and seek employment. Wartime leaders give employment. Let me give you another example. Peacetime IB is to get a 45. Schools go into a euphoric state. That Prachi Agarwal has got a 45. She's all over Facebook. Everybody is gloating, shouting, screaming. Parents are loading her with gifts. I'm only giving her name because I can see her on the screen over here. Ashleksha Gala. She's getting gifts. She's getting necklaces. She's got 45. She has got about 500 people on her WhatsApp who are congratulating her. She needs 3 or 4 days to answer all the things over there. The placement people are just going crazy. That we've got so many 45. The DP coordinator is going nuts. He just can't stop dancing. He just can't stop dancing. Wartime IB. Wartime IB has got nothing to do with 45. Wartime IB says, are you are you future ready? In other words, are you startup ready? Is Prachi Agarwal at grade 12, is she ready to start a startup company? That is wartime DP objective. So Prachi Agarwal is not wasting her time thinking of how to go to America with the lockdown over there, how will the education happen? Will it be online, this and that? She is now starting her own company in Hyderabad. We look at the university part later, she says. Because she is startup ready. She has the mentality of an entrepreneur. This is the difference. So as I said to you, there's a sharp contrast between peacetime students, peacetime schools, peacetime leaders, and wartime children. Peacetime children are passive learners. They go to class with empty heads, empty vessels, and they want teacher madam to pour knowledge into their heads. They're handicapped. They're dependent on the teacher. They're dependent on content. Wartime student is a self-directed learner. He learns on her own. She learns on her own. He learns on her own. She's got the skills of learning it on her own. Teachers are there to just clarify a few issues. There's a difference between a wartime student and a peacetime student. A wartime student takes ownership for her learning. A peacetime student is helpless. Madam, please tell us what is to be written there. They're just looking at madam as if madam is the epitome of knowledge, of Mercury, of Minerva. So now that you're graduating, your mentality has to change. You're now in the wide, wide world. Only the fit will survive. And the fit are the people who are innovative. The fit are the people who are entrepreneurs. The fit are the people who are wartime leaders. So what is this? What do you have to do? Before you got to do, you got to ask yourself a question. Are you ready? Are you a wartime leader? Most of us are not. So, the first thing which you got to do is that you have to look at problems as opportunities, not as obstacles. So, when a problem comes in front of you, whether it is to go to which university or which whom to marry or what job to take, whatever it is, you should look at it as an opportunity. An opportunity for innovation, an opportunity for unlocking your potential, an opportunity for being successful, and an opportunity for failing and learning. You must fail fast and learn fast. You must look for opportunities to fail also, taking up tough, audacious goals. Ladies and gentlemen, opportunities open doors. Coronavirus is an opportunity. Take coronavirus as a great opportunity. We've all been talking about Pareto's law, the principle, the 20-80 or the 80-20 principle. That only 20% things are critical, 80% is trivial. Spend 80% of your time on the 20% and your output will be 80%. That's the mantra. The mantra for wartime condition is 1090. Or I would say 595. For the leader, it is 595. Only 5% things are critical in battle. Everything else are supernumeraries. Yeah, trivia. A wartime soldier goes to battle with one bullet in his chamber. He focuses intently on the target, which is your goal. He knows he must hit the target or else he will die. One idea grips you. You dream that idea, you sleep that idea, you walk that idea, you think that idea. We'll tackle it a little later on. When there's a lull in battle. So when there are lulls and pauses in battle, we'll look at that 95. So what is your 5%? You have to identify quickly what is your 5%. 20% is all outdated stuff. That is all history now. Moore's law and Pareto's principle are history. They are in the archives. You may find them in the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C. They're not relevant to it. I've spoken about innovation, and I won't labor that point. But the spiritual side, the philosophical side of a wartime leader is something which you've got to pay very serious attention to. Wartime leaders have a purpose, higher goal. And that higher goal translates into a vision. These two things don't change at all. They are the constants. Corona will come, corona will go, climate change will come, climate change will go, cybers will come, terrorists will come, everything will be, the world will be churning up. This will not change. Your purpose and your vision will not change, and they will help you to maintain sanity. They'll help you to give you direction in which to move. They will give you motivation. They will give you self-esteem. They will give you courage. And they will give you hope. Purpose and vision are the only constants. They are your North Star. They are your true star. That's your magnetic north. When you open your GPS, it re-centers you. Purpose and vision re-centers you. And people who are driven by a purpose and vision, you can isolate them for 27 years, like what happened to Mandela, but nothing happened to Mandela. After 27, he came out strong. And we, after 4 to 6 weeks or 7 or 8 weeks, are, you know, collapsing. What the hell is that? We're developing all sides of psychological disorder at home, at work, wherever. Because Mandela's, Churchill's, they were driven by a purpose. They had a vision. They turned that purpose into a vision. They translate that into a vision. That doesn't change. Everything around will change. So when you need guidance in life, that do I do this or do I do that? Do I go to Princeton? Do I go to Harvard? Do I go to Brown? Do I go to Flame? Do I go to Pokatpalli? Your purpose and vision will give you the answer. Nothing else. I don't know whether you have seen, how many of you have seen the film The Godfather. I think many of you were not even born. Have a look at the film. Some lot of Academy Awards. Al Pacino plays Michael Corleone, the mafia boss. In that film, Michael Corleone dismisses Tom Hagen. Tom Hagen was the consigliere. A consigliere is a member of the mafia family who advises Godfather what to do. So Michael sacks him. Tom has been there for a long time. He's a member of the family. So Hagen says, he says, Mike, why am I out? Corleone says, you are not a wartime consigliere, Tom. Things are going to get rough with the moves we are trying to do now. It is all right. Those days, you know, when mafia was ruling and everything was right, you were a good advisor. But now that the police are after us and a lot of things are happening in the world today, Italy is collaborating with the United States to catch hold of us and all the things over there. The going is getting tough and we are planning big projects. You are a peacetime advisor. So you understand the psyche of a person who goes, even advisors have got to be wartime advisors. Who will advise you not only during ideal conditions, but will give you a sound advice during turbulent times. What do we do now? In summary, ladies and gentlemen, peacetime leaders have no future in this movement. You believe me. They have no future to be happy and to be and to survive and to make other people happy, other people survive. You need the DNA of a wartime leader. And a wartime leader in modern times is called an entrepreneur. Wartime leader who is driven by purpose, by vision, by seeking opportunities, having extreme focus, 595, extreme focus. What is your 5? Forget about the 95. What is your 5? What is the teacher's 5? What is the student's 5? What is my 5? When there are lulls and pauses in the war and battle, there will be. We will look at the 95. For the time being, we are not worried about it. You take care of it. A lot of parents complain that too much of screen time is being used by our children now under these lockdown conditions. Yeah, we know it's not very good, but let's not worry about screen time right now. There are bigger things which are on my table right now than worry about. Once the situation is okay, corona vaccine has come and we get back to some normalcy, we'll look at screen time. This is not the time to be looking at screen time. That is a peacetime psyche. What is going to happen to our kids? They're wasting too much of time on the screen. Yeah, okay, it's bad, it's not good. We know that. But under the circumstances, it is the only thing that's going to work. It is the only vaccine that's available right now. So let's not worry about, so that screen time aspect is part of 95%. So we'll look at that later on. Let us not waste our time and start worrying about inconsequential. In wanting to be a wartime leader, entrepreneur, I would like to add 2 more to your list. There's a very fine book written by Andy Grove, the founder of Intel. Must read it. Only the paranoid survive. Only the paranoid survive. To survive, you got to be humble and you got to be hungry. That is the basis and foundation of having a healthy paranoid temperament. What does this temperament, this paranoid temperament look like? The first thing is there should be no complacency after success. The enemy of success, the enemy of progress is complacency. When we win a gold medal, when we win a title, when we become 45 out of 45, complacency sets in. I am the last word. Even God has to consult with me. Now this problem is to be solved. So complacency after success. That is the humbleness. That I said, be humble and be hungry. So be humble. There are many people waiting out there to pull you down. Focus on your 5%. Extreme focus. You survive. Be innovation-minded to solve difficult problems. I've spoken to you a lot about it. I've spoken to you about leadership speed. Speed in planning, speed in decision, speed in communication, speed in feedback, speed in anything that is 5%. Whatever falls under 5% is speed. It's part of 5%. You got to get your answers today. Now, this time, as I speak to you. And you're going to decentralize. You're going to decentralize. And we can only react with speed, provided you are trained to think two levels up and act one level up. It's very easy to say decentralize. You cannot decentralize unless your subordinates are capable of thinking two levels up and acting one level up. That is the capability which you must have. Otherwise, you will be nothing but Tom Hagen, who will be sacked by Michael Corleone. To be all-time leader, you must have the ability to think two levels up and act one level up. Only then the paranoid will survive. And fifthly, in the peacetime model, you had people who are very good in having ideas, and you had very good in people who are executing. And often you come across, oh, she's a very fine person, give her a task and she will go flat out about it. But she's a worker. She's just looking over her shoulders, waiting for orders to come. What is to be done? She does it diligently and she does a good job. She works hard, but she doesn't work smart. In wartime, you have to be an idea person and an action person. Not only come up with ideas, but to execute ideas. Only a person who can only execute ideas and doesn't come up with ideas has no future. I'd like you to understand that today the world is going through the largest psychological experiment ever, where 7.3 billion people are part of that psychological experiment. Pandemics bring in a lot of psychological pressure. Some of you may already be experiencing some less and some more. Your parents may be experiencing that. These could vary from irritability, getting on each other's nerves, argumentative. And we've had some parents, I've been talking to parents of all the three schools, that some of our children get very argumentative. Why should I do this thing? I will not do this thing. That's kind of stress. Irritability. To lose their cool and calm. Anxiety. Anxiety about, will I go to university or not? Will the university in London open or not? Should I go now, take a gap year and go next year? What do I do? Financial worries. My business is collapsing. I have no money. How am I going to sustain? I've got two kids. What is going to happen about the second one? So anxiety, worries, stress, burnout. These are all the psychological dimensions. And when you continue with it for a long time, under isolation, conditions of isolation, you can become pretty challenging. And when it becomes challenging, those individuals suffer from what is called PTSD, post-trauma stress disorder. And they go into an emotional spin. They can't take charge of their life. And PTSD can take months, it can take weeks, it may never end. At least 35% of soldiers in battle suffer from PTSD, being either onlookers or victims of traumatic experiences. It is some sort of a traumatic experience. But there is an antidote to this. And that is what the entrepreneurial leader has to train herself and himself and to apply it on others. It's called post-traumatic growth. It's a part of positive psychology. How do you as a teacher, how do you as a leader how do you as a student in your personal capacity immunize yourself, vaccine yourself, build up that psychological immunity to withstand the psychological pressures of being in isolation for protracted periods? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. It is post-traumatic growth, which means to find meaning and creativity in adversity. You should look at adversity as a great training exercise, as a training field. You can only grow in adversity. Countries, societies, which have come up in adversity, become very strong. Look at Israel. They have a population of 7.5 million people. Nobody can mess around with them. They shoot first and ask questions later. You kill three of their children, they'll come and kill 3,000 of your children. You can't mess around with them. I want you to understand one thing. And I'd like you to make a note. Suffering ceases to be suffering the moment it finds meaning. Suffering ceases to be a suffering the moment it finds meaning. This is what Viktor Frankl said in his famous book, which I'm sure all of you have read, Man's Search for Meaning. You can turn suffering into a triumph. You can turn tragedy into a victory, if you can find meaning in it. In every situation, there is meaning. This is a situation to be innovative, to be a wartime. Ladies and gentlemen, instead of being reactive, waiting for pandemic environment or what comes after the pandemic environment, and then start reacting to it. As a wartime leader, armed with purpose, meaning, and vision, you must design your future. Rather than wait for the future to come and make a mess of you. You decide what you want to do, what your vision, your purpose is. You decide what your vision is going to be. However imperfect it may be, it doesn't make a difference. As I've always said, that only an who is a perfect person? There is no perfect person. The only perfect person is an imperfect person. The more imperfect you are, the more perfect you're going to be. And I want you to understand what a great African proverb quoted in Malcolm X's biography, the great American civil rights leader. That tomorrow belongs to the people who prepare for it today. I've spoken to you about tomorrow. I've spoken to you what you have to do to prepare yourself. Now is the time you must start your preparations. I want you again to understand that coronavirus is a great gift to mankind. It is God's great gift to mankind. It is bringing in a lot of humility in us. As I said to your teachers yesterday, there is something in sickness that breaks down the pride of man. It makes us mortal human beings. And there was this great story which originated amongst the Sufi poets in the 19th century Persia, the great days of Rumi and his associates. And there was this story goes that there was this big king, he's a monarch. Monarchs are bigger than a king, big king. And he called all his wise men together, all the Tom Higgins together. And he said to them that, listen, I want you to invent a short sentence which can be engraved on this ring of mine, king's ring. I want that sentence to be engraved on this ring of mine. And that sentence should be such, the word should be such, that whenever I'm down and out, whenever I'm very, very happy and successful over there, it's going to give me happiness and give me a lot of hope. So all these wise men, they got into a huddle. They came up with the answer. The answer was, and this too shall pass. And this too shall pass. This therefore talks about the temporary nature of the human condition. These are all temporary, they'll come and go. What is going to remain constant, my friends? Going to be the purpose, the vision. I would like you to reflect and introspect today. How much of a wartime leader you are. I've told you what you need to do to be a wartime leader. I've told you that 5% things, five I've told you. There are a few other things also. But I've told you the five. Are you a wartime leader? What do you have to do to be a wartime leader? Do you have a purpose? Do you have a vision? You can't be a leader without a purpose and a vision. Those who have no purpose and those who have no vision, especially so in this new world that has emerged, they shall perish. The only way we can be happy and successful in life and make other people happy, it's not good enough for you to be happy. You've got to make other people happy. It's not good for you only to be optimistic. You've got to give hope to other people. As a leader, wartime leader, you're a messenger of hope. You're not a messenger of doom. And this too shall pass. So with these words, I would like to, on behalf of Indus, all your teachers who've been working so hard with you for the last 2 years, wish you nothing but the very best in life. And I have no doubt that even if you remember 5 or 10% of what I said, it will be worth it. Thank you very much and may God bless you.